Okay, today topic is security, Spring security. Spring Boot by default not providing a security. Okay, if you develop any endpoint, any RESTful endpoint, that particular endpoint anyone can access. It's publicly available. There is no security. Okay, but in the real world, we should not do like that, right? We have to make it security. We have to make it security. Whatever endpoint you'll go and develop, certain APIs available for publicly to access. Certain API definitely we should not allow to access. We have to protect that API. We have to protect that API. For that, we have to use Spring Security. We have to provide authentication as well as authorization. What is authentication? Using authentication, we can check whenever user requests any endpoint, we need to verify the particular user valid username or not. If it is valid user, we need to allow him to do further manipulation. Otherwise, we have to throw valid error to the client side. This username and the password is not a valid. Something like that. We have to give some relevant error. After login, that user have some certain restriction. This particular resource he can access. This particular resource he cannot access. Like that, we can provide some permission. That is called as an authorization. Using authorization, we can restrict the access from the server, from the resource. Authentication is we are allowing to log in, come into the server resources. Now, whenever you're trying to access any resource by the client, we have to check that particular user is authorized person to access this resource. Through authorization, we can prevent that. Okay. By default, Spring is not a security. We have to enable security. So to configure default security is very, very easy in Spring Boot. Configuring a default security is very, very easy in a Spring Boot. We have to add one artifact. We have to add one artifact called Spring Boot Starter Security. We have to add one starter project is a dependency. Okay, we have to add one starter project called Spring Boot Starter Security. Once you add this artifact, automatically your Spring Boot enabled security is enabled. Okay, it never allow any endpoint. Once you add this starter project in your application, whatever endpoint you try to access, it never allow to access. We have to provide some username password, some default username password. Spring generate one default username password. We have to provide that default username password to access particular endpoint. Okay. Now I'm going to create one project. I think Deepan was asking some question, how to, instead of going to the starter website, how to create a project from IntelliJ itself. To achieve that, you need to install one plugin. Okay, go to, I told that in last session itself, but last session some people, most of the people absent, so I am repeating that. Go to settings. Here you can see plugin. In the plugin section, go and search Spring. Go and search Spring. Here you can see Spring Assistant. Here, this is the Spring Assistant is a plugin we have to install. Okay, here I have installed already, so it's showing the installed. Okay, once you installed, restart the IntelliJ, then you can create a project from ID itself, IntelliJ ID itself. Okay, go to File, New Project. Then in this window, in the left side, you can see Spring Assistant. Click that. Once you click that, by default, select start.spring.io, right? Default. Select that. Click next. Then provide whatever information you need. Whatever you enter in that website, right? That same thing. Security demo. I'm saying security demo. 8. Then I'm saying IT guard. Next. Security, go to select security, then select Spring Security, then click next. I want to create a project under under session 10 I have to create this project. Okay, finish, then create. It will ask how do you want to open. Select new window. Okay, in a pom.xml file, you can see here, you can dependency, Spring Boot started security, it's added, right? Now I'll going to disable that. Okay, I'll going to comment out. Then I'll going to create a one class, one package called controller. Controller, inside a package, I'll going to create a one simple controller. Test controller. Then at test controller public string print, I'm saying print at get mapping return this first string security. I'm saying just I'm printing returning one simple string. Okay. Now I'm going to start the server. What happened? Oh, sorry. I missed to add that web starter project, right? That is I missed. That's the reason it's giving this error. I selected only security artifact, right? Security starter project. That's the reason it's giving the error. We need to add web also. Okay, we are developing a web RESTful web services, right? So we need to add this for web MEC for a REST web. For web MEC and RESTful web services, we need to add this, right? There is a mandate. I have not selected this artifact. That's the reason the server is not starting. Now this annotation, I need to, whenever I add this artifact, whenever I add any artifact, better reload project. Okay. Now I'll start the application. I'm uncommenting the testing related artifact because there is some default class created under test folder. Those packages not recognized because of commenting out that this particular dependency. Okay, I'm now uncommenting it. Now I'm going to reload. Okay, and now I'm starting the server. This time it will go everything fine. The server started now. Here I created one small endpoint, right? Let me try to access this endpoint. Okay. Saying that, I'm going to say it's a print. Okay. It's a print. Go to browser. Localhost slash print. Okay, now I'm able to access this because I have not enabled the Spring security. So I'm able to access this endpoint without authentication. Okay, now what I'm going to do? Go to the pom.xml file. I'm going to uncomment this artifact. I'm going to uncomment this artifact. Now restart the application. Please watch this log. What's happening here? Okay, I need to reload it. Nothing's happening. I need to reload it. Maven reload. Okay. Now I'm going to start the application again. Now you can see here using generated security password. This is a security password. If you want to access any endpoint from this point, from now on, if you want to access any endpoint available in this application, you need to use this password. Username is by default user. Okay. Without providing this information, you cannot access. Now I try to access this endpoint again. Automatically, Spring Boot throws one login form. Please sign in. Default username is user. Password is this. This is the password. Now I am able to log. So this is a Spring Boot default auto configuration. Whenever I add security starter project, it will create one username and a password. Using that username and a password, you can access any endpoint. Okay, but this is not good, right? We have to customize that. We have to customize according to our need. Okay, we'll do step by step. Now we understand that how to enable a Spring security in our application. Okay, whenever add this artifact, by default, our application enabled the Spring security. We have to use system generated username and a password. Okay. If you want to log out, if you want to log out from here, we have to say one URL called log out. It will ask, are you sure want to log out? Yeah, it's login. Again, if you want to access, it never print. It will ask username and password. We have to give that username and password, then only we can access. Okay. Now I want to go with my own username and password. Next step is how to customize with our own username and password. Okay. I'm going to close this project. I have created some project for you guys. Okay, I don't want to use write a code here. I don't want to waste your time. File open recent. Okay, in this security demo one, project name is security demo one. See here also I added the Spring security endpoint. Then apart from this, I added one more class called my security config. My security config, one classes I added here. This my security classes, we have to extend with web security configurer adapter. If you want to customize, if you want to configure security in your application, we need to create one configuration class. That configuration class must extend with web security configure adapter. Okay. Now I want to go with my own username and password. Here we have to override one method called configure method. Configure method, which is coming from web security configure adapter, we have to override in order to go with our own username and password. In the real time, we have to take the username and password from the database. That section we'll going to see later. Okay, now we'll going to we'll improve step by step. Okay, in this example, I'm making this username password Spring Boot in memory. Spring Boot in memory itself, I want to create a one user. Username and a password. Through that username and a password, I want to access my endpoints. Okay. For that, we need to create override one method called configure method. That configure method having one method parameter called authentication manager builder. Using this authentication manager builder only, we can authorize particular username and a password. Okay. In this authentication manager builder, I am saying auth dot in memory authentication. I want to perform in memory authentication. Then I am saying I want to use this user. I want to create this user inside a Spring Boot in memory with user. Username is a Joe. His password is a Joe123. Then I am saying that Joe user should have a role called user. I'm saying this Joe user having a role called user. As of now, according to this configuration, this role is meaningless. the next example, I will going to tell how to work with rules. As of now, please forget about this particular point. Just focus, we are focusing only how to create a user inside a Spring in memory. Okay, I am creating a user called Joe. His password is Joe123. Then I want to create one more user, Mark. His password is Mark123. Okay, his password is Mark123. His role is admin. Okay, don't worry about the role now. If you specify any username and password, we need to tell how do you want to access that particular password, how do you want to keep that password inside a memory. I am saying here no OP password encoder. This meaning that I want to keep it plain password. I don't want to encrypt. Now in this example, we are creating two user in Spring in memory authentication. In Spring in memory, then I'm keeping that user password in a plain password. I'm not encrypted. I make it everything simple in this example. Okay. The first step is we need to add the artifact in the pom.xml file. 1 minute. Sorry guys, sorry for disturbance. Some disturbance is here. Okay. So the first step is we need to add the artifact. Second step is we need to create one class. That class extended with a web security configure adapter. Then that class must be enabled with enable web security annotation. Then that class should be configuration class. Okay, should be a configuration class. This particular class execute at the time of starting the server. And then create these users. Okay, in the Spring in memory. Spring Boot in memory. Then I am saying my password is must be plain password. I don't want to encrypt now. Okay. Now I completed the creating a username and a password. Okay. Then here I created a two endpoints. One is a default method. I am saying it's a default method. Return. This is default mapping. If you want to access this particular endpoint, what you will do? http://localhost:8080. Whenever access this endpoint, automatically this method get invoked. This is for, if you want to access this method, we have to say localhost:8080/print. Okay. Now, if you want to access this method, I want to provide username and password. Otherwise, you cannot access. Okay. Let's see that now. So far fine, no questions, no doubts. We understand these sections and all, configuration sections. Okay, I'm starting the server now. Server started. If you want to access this endpoint, for both the cases, it will ask username and password. What is my username and password here? Joe123. So this is a default mapping printing. That is, I'm invoking this particular endpoint. Now I can access this also because I already logged in now. So I'm able to access. Now I'm going to log out. What is the another user? Another user is a Mark and Mark123. So going to default mapping. Okay, then if you want to access that print, I'm able to access print by the mark. So after login using Joe and Mark, I'm able to access this endpoint. Okay. Now you understand that how to create a username and a password in the Spring Boot in memory. But this is for only example purpose. I am explaining. But finally, we have to come up with database. Okay. Now I'll going to stop the server. I'll going to open another project.
So can you show that a password encoder method on the configuration file?
Okay. Yeah.
That one, line number 24.
Yeah, this is a mandate. Yeah. Here I am saying I don't want to encode password. That's it.
Okay,
this is a next example. It's coming with password encoder. Okay, now I'm opening a spring. This is a Spring Boot 3, right? 1. Okay, 2. Oh, this is also no password. I think it's the next example. Okay, mark 1, 2, 3. I'll close all the examples. I'll close this also. This is just now we saw. Okay, no. I don't want to keep it this also. Okay. Security demo 3. Security demo 3. Here also same thing. I created a class, configuration class. Here I have overridden one more method. Here I have overridden one more method. This method, the last example, I have overridden this method. I created a configuration. I created a configuration. Through this configuration, added two user, right? In this time, I created a three different user. Then here I overriding one more method called configure. One more method called configure with a different parameter. Okay. Auth dot in memory authentication. I want to create a user in memory with user Suresh. I want to store this password in the encoder format. I want to encrypt this format. That's the reason I'm saying password encoder. Here, when you look at here, I'm creating one bin, right? A password encoder. I am calling this method here. I'm calling this method. The last example, I'm saying I was calling a different call. That call saying that no password. That is, I don't want to encrypt the password. But here, I'm saying return you bcrypt password encoder. Bcrypt password encoder. In the last example, what I'm doing here? The last example, just I'm saying no password encoder. That meaning I don't want to encrypt the password. That is the meaning of this configuration. Okay, but here I am saying I want to encrypt the password. So I am initializing one class called return new bcrypt password encoder. I am initializing one class called bcrypt encode passworder. Whenever create the user, what I am doing, I'm calling this method, get password encoder, encode 1, 2, 3. Whatever password I am providing here, please encode it. That is, I'm encrypting and keep it in the Spring Boot in memory. Okay. Then this user role is the super admin. What is the meaning of this line? I'm creating a user called user. If password is 1, 2, 3, I want to encrypt this password using this particular method and keep it in memory. Then I am assigning one role. This user having one role called super admin. Similarly, I am creating another user, Mark. I am encrypting his password. His role is admin. Then I am creating one more user, Joe. His password is a 1, 2, 3, and encrypting his password. His role is a user. Now, according to this configuration, I have created three users, three different roles. Now, I want to give some permission to this role. I want to restrict something. Previous example, just I created a role, but I have not mentioned anything. I have not given any configuration in terms of roles, right? Now, we're going to see how to give some authority to particular roles. For that, we need to override one more method called configure method. That configure method accepting one parameter called HTTP security HTTP security. Okay. Here, ant matcher is a method. In that method, we have to say which URL. We have to pass for endpoint URL. Okay, here I'm saying slash user. I'm saying slash user as any role. Slash user as any role. Please listen carefully. I'm passing slash user. Then I'm calling one more method as any role. Inside this method, we need to pass whatever role you want to pass. Here I'm passing user under super admin. That meaning, whatever user having this role, user and the super admin, those user only can access this particular path. When you look at this configuration, I created three user in which Suresh and Joy is a, Suresh is a super admin role. So the user path can access by Suresh because Suresh is a super admin. Then here Joy is a user role. This particular slash user path can access by role of user. That role is assigned to Joe. So this particular path can access by Joe and Suresh. Others, Joe cannot access admin because I have not mentioned here slash admin. When I say slash admin, as any role, admin person and a super admin person can access this particular path. Who is admin here? Admin is a Suresh. Sorry, Mark is admin, right? Mark is admin. He can access this path. Who is super admin? Super admin is a Suresh. So Suresh also can access this, but sorry guys. Who is a super admin? Super admin is a Suresh, right? Suresh also access this particular path. Who is admin? Mark is admin. Mark also can access this particular path. But this path cannot access by role user. Who is the user? Joe is a user role. He cannot access this particular admin path. Then one more thing, super admin path. This super admin has role super admin, I am saying. This particular path only accessed by super admin. This path cannot access by user under admin role. Okay, user under admin role. Because I am saying here super admin has role only super admin. Who is a super admin? Super admin is a Suresh. Suresh can access user path. According to this configuration, Suresh can access all the endpoint available here. Okay. Then this particular slash permit all, anyone can access this root path. Okay. Then when this validation happen, whenever we have to show form login. In the form login, it will validate. Then according to this particular configuration, I want to keep that encrypted password in the Spring Boot in memory. Okay, this is the configuration with creating a user plus assigning a roles to the each user. Now we'll go to validate this particular configuration is working or not. Okay. Okay, one more thing I forgot to tell here. This path I already defined. Where I defined? In the controller class. The customer controller, see here. User. This user get mapping return, this is a user page. This admin path return, this is a admin page. Super admin return, this is a super admin page. Can you tell now? This admin path, this particular endpoint, who can access according to this configuration? Can you guess? Just I want to validate if people are understand. When I try to access this particular admin endpoint, this admin endpoint method, Who can access here?
Admin and supervisor.
Mark, only Mark.
Only Mark. Which?
This Mark one? And Suresh.
Yeah, Mark and Suresh can access. Mark and according to this configuration, Mark and Suresh can access the particular admin page. Okay, guys, good. Now I'm going to show the demo. First, we'll validate this user. It asks username and a password. Now I want to provide user is a Joe and the password is a 123. Joe and the password is a 123. So this is a user page. Now I'll go to log out. Now I want to log in as a Mark Suresh. Suresh and what is the password? Suresh password is a 123. He is the admin, right? He's super admin. He able to access this page. It's going to, this is a get default mapping. Spring Boot by default redirecting to this particular default mapping. So no worries. Now I want to access this particular user page. So the user, this user page also accessed by super admin. So user under super admin able to access. That meaning Suresh under Joe can able to access this particular page. Now I want to try to access by admin. That is Mark. Sorry guys. Mark under 123. Now it will go to default page. Everyone can access that, right? In the configuration, you can see here. This particular page path everyone can access. That's the reason it's going here. Now I log in as a Mark. I want to access user. Forbidden. It's restricting. It's not allowing to access this particular page by Mark user. Mark user, because Mark user does not have access of this user page. Okay, now user is a page working as expected. Now I'll go to log out. Now I want to try with Mark admin page. Okay, now I'll go to try to log with Mark under 123. He must be able to access because he is having a permission. It will go to default page. Now I want to say admin. Sorry. So Mark able to access admin page. I'm going to log out. Then I want to say Suresh 123. Sign in. It will go to default page. Now I want to access admin page by login. Super admin, right? Suresh. So super admin also able to access. Okay. Now I want to access this page by login user. That is Joe. So going to default page slash admin. Saying forbidden because Joe is a user role. It does not have access to access this particular page. Now I want to log in as a super admin, that is a Suresh. He must have access of all pages. It will go into default page. Now I'm trying to access user, able to access admin, able to access. Then what is the another endpoint? Super admin. Super admin. Okay. Now, based on the configuration, working everything perfectly. Okay. This is the way of restricting the particular endpoint from the user, based on the user role. Okay. I hope you understand these configurations. What is the next? Next one is security demo 4. Here I created one simple controller. Okay, it's a post mapping. It's having a customer as a body. Customer having some fields attributes. It is a normal attribute as usual. What we are seeing all the examples in our previous examples. Then I'm returning the customer as a response. Simple endpoint. And go to the security config. Security config. Here you can see a little bit different. You added two more attribute. I had mentioned customer user detail service, then basic request filter. Customer user detail service and a basic request filter. Two classes I annotated here, auto-wired here. Then here in this configure method, I override the configure method, but I am not using in-memory authentication. I am not using in-memory authentication. I want to take username and a password from the database. Okay, but this example not from the database. I want you two people do that assignment. Okay, but I will help you that. But this example not using in-memory authentication. Instead of in-memory authentication, using one class called customer user details. When you go to inside a customer user details, this particular user details service class implements user details. Implements user details. This user details service is a class interface which is coming from Spring Boot Security API, Spring Framework Security API. It's coming from there. Okay, I am implement that particular user details service. Then I am overriding. I am overriding that method. I am overriding that method. Using I'm overriding one method called load user by name. After implementing this particular interface, I'm overriding one method called load user by username. Load user by username. It has a one parameter called string username. String username. Then if you see inside this method, there's a one small implementation. Return new user. This user is coming from again our Spring Framework Security API. Okay, I'm using that one. Return new user. Then I'm saying username is a Suresh. Password is a 123. Password is a 123. Then third parameter is a new array list. The new array list nothing but the roles. We need to mention roles, which is having particular user. This user does not have any roles now. That's the reason I'm passing empty array list. That's the reason I'm passing empty array list. Okay. These are very simple implementation. Actually, what will happen here? This particular user at 123, right? The hardcoded value, right? It should coming from database. It should come from database. We have to take it from database. Then that user we need to load here. That user we need to assign here. That is the actual proper way. But for make it simple. To understand better, I am not going with the database now. Okay, then it will become a bit complex. It will make it will be it will become some understanding problem. Okay, to make it simple, then we'll see that example. Okay, now here hard coding user under 123. Okay, now go back to the configuration file. Go back to the configuration file. I will talk about later about this filter. Here I override one method called configure. This is the method we've overridden to creating a user everything, right? To creating a in-memory users and creating a role for that user. We use the same method in the previous example. I'm using same method here also. Instead of this in-memory authentication, I am calling this auth.userDetailService. Auth.userDetailService. I am saying this particular class Authentication Manager Builder is the API which is coming from Spring Boot. I am saying through this configuration, I am saying to this class, please take classes. Please take the classes from this particular class. This class provide the data, username which is coming from database. Please use that class for your authentication purpose. Please use this class for authentication purpose. When you look at this class, it's loading the data. Authenticate, whenever authenticate, okay, what will happen, this authentication manager builder go to this configuration, it will check, okay, this in this configuration they're saying use this method, use this class. So it will go to this class under call this class, under call this class. Whenever call this class, here I am returning user under 123, right? So this username and the password returned by authentication manager builder. Authentication manager builder, that username and the password validated against username and the password entered by the client. Okay, so previously I'm using in-memory authentication. I created everything here. Instead of doing this one configuration, here I am saying that use this particular class. This class provide you the username. This class provide you the username. Please use that username and the password for your validation. For your validation, whenever user client enter username and the password, what will happen? This particular authentication manager builder load the username and password coming from the database. As of now, we are hard coded. Load the username password coming from this particular class. Here it will return user under 123, right? According to the configuration, return user under 123. That user under 123 matches whatever username entered we are entering. Okay. If that matches, it allows the further manipulation. Otherwise, it will failure. You understand the configuration of this particular method now?
Sir, can you open that interface class once again? User details.
Yeah.
That interface, user details service.
Nothing here.
Hmm? Okay, nothing.
Yeah, here we have this for this given for our purpose. Okay. Using this particular method, right? Using this particular method, you can load username from anywhere. Okay. Now I'm hard coding here. And then we can load this username anywhere. It could be a database, it could be some other place. We can load and assign that username and password in this user object. This user object used by this authentication manager builder to validate the username and password that is entered by the client. Okay. The next step is, again, I'm going to overriding the configure method. Overriding the configure method. You are not restricting anything here, but what I'm saying is http.csrf.disable. Disabling cross site request forgery. I will explain later about this. Then authorize request. Any request authenticator. Any request authenticate, that meaning of that, whatever request coming from the client, I want to validate all the requests. I want to validate all the requests. That is called this particular meaning of this particular line. Then I want to manage session policy as a stateless. That is the configuration of this particular method. Okay, configuration particular method is whatever username, whatever request making from the client, all endpoint I want to validate. According to this configuration, without username and a password, we cannot use any endpoint. Okay, then.
Sir, explain once again 42, 43 lines. Once again, explain. 42, 43 lines.
Authorize request means whatever request you are making from postman, that is any request, any endpoint, that could be postman, that could be any from anywhere. Okay, any, I want to authenticate all the requests. Authorize request, any request dot authenticator, that is please authenticate any request coming for authorization. Any request coming from the client side, you have to authenticate. I am saying here. Okay. That is the meaning of this particular two lines. Then, apart from this configuration, we need to create one more bin called authentication manager. Authentication manager. I will tell later about this meaning of this particular bin. Okay, now in this example, what we're going to do, we're going to write our own code for authentication. So far what we have done, Spring Boot doing the authentication automatically, right? Spring Boot doing authentication automatically. But in this example, I want to write some code to authenticate. I want to write some code for authenticate. Whatever username, password entered in the postman, I want to find out that particular username and the password valid or not. Valid or not. Okay. And that particular piece of code I want to write. Through that code, I want to evaluate that username and the password is valid. Username and the password is valid. Okay. Now, how to do that? For that, I am adding one more line here. 47. HTTP add filter before. Add filter before. Add filter before this filter. This is a Spring Boot authentication filter. This is a Spring Boot default authentication filter. Username, password authentication filter. This filter automatically executed by Spring Boot application. Now I want to authenticate in my own. For that, I have to create one more filter. My custom filter I have to create. I am saying through this configuration, I am saying, please call my filter. Please call my filter before calling this filter. Please call my filter before calling this filter. Whenever user requesting to call any API, please call this filter before calling this filter through this method. Okay, now we'll go to this particular filter. Basic request filter. This filter class must annotated with add component class. Add component class, then only we can register inside a Spring application context. Then extend with once per request filter. Once per request filter. Normally in the filter example, what you have done, we have implemented the filter interface, right? That act as a filter. But here basic request filter, extend once per request filter. Where is coming from this filter? Again, this filter coming from Spring framework only. Okay. Using this filter, we can ensure that whenever send a request, I want to execute this time, I want to execute this method only one. I want to give the guarantee. For other filters, we cannot give a guarantee like that. Through this filter, I can give a guarantee. Whenever client send a request, I want to execute this filter only one time. Only one time. For that, we are using extend once per request filter. Then here I'm auto-wiring authentication manager. I have registered this particular bin class in my security configurator. See here, authentication manager bin. I'm returning this. Okay, this particular bin I'm using here. What is the purpose of this bin? To authenticate by yourself. Using this particular class, you can authenticate your username and password in our own. For that purpose, we can use this class. In the previous example, we have not used, right? Here we are using. The reason is we need to authenticate. We have to authenticate through our code. So I need to utilize this method for authenticating a username and a password, which is coming from client side. Then I am using customer user details service, which we explained detail previously, right? You know about this class. Okay, I will tell exactly where I'm going to use this class in our code. Okay, now I hopefully understand about these sections. Now we'll go into the implementation, authentication implementation section. Do filter internal. This particular filter, if you extend this filter, we have to override a method called do filter internal. Here we have a three argument: request, response, filter chain. Okay, then string authorization equal to HTTP servlet request dot get header. Now postman, right? What is the endpoint for this controller? Here endpoint is a print, right? Print. If you want to access this particular endpoint, what you have to do? We have to use this particular endpoint. Then it will go into access. If you want to access this endpoint, we have to be a proper authorized person. Then only we can access. For that, we need to provide username and password. According to in our example, if you want to access this endpoint, we need to provide username and password, right? In the postman. How do you enter username and password in postman? Go to auth. Whatever authorization we are using now, it's a basic auth. Okay. Click this basic auth. section, go to section, click this basic auth. Then say here, what is the username password here? I configured in the customer user detail, Suresh123, right? We have to pass the same thing here, Suresh123. Okay. Whenever, after configure, when you send this endpoint, what will happen? Postman send this data like this format. In the header, postman send this data. Authorization is header name. It will send user colon 123. After adding username and password, at that time you are sending this data, postman take this username and password and encrypt this username and password. In this format only. Encrypt this username and password and send it to our server in the header. Okay. When you look at here, you know filter behavior, right? Whenever send any request, filter get execute. Filter get execute in the very first line. In this method, very first line, I am saying HTTP servlet request get header. I am saying that is the header. We have this data, right? Header name is authorization. That value is Suresh123 in an encrypted form. That value I am taking here. And assigning to authorization string. Now this string is a encrypted string. Okay. Then this particular encrypted data, how it will look? This is a basic authentication, right? So it will send like this. Basic space your Suresh123 like this. Encrypted form. Some encrypted data colon some encrypted like this it will send. Okay. In the encrypted form. I am taking the encrypted data. Then here I am saying authorization substring of 6. According to this data, right? We no need to this particular section because it's saying that this particular authorization is a basic authentication. So it's giving that basic in the prefix, giving basics one space. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I want to substring this particular data. I want to take only this line. Only encrypted data I want to take. Encrypted credential I want to take. I am taking that and assigning to here. Now, according to this particular line, we have a encrypted username and a password. Now, next step is we need to decrypt this encrypted value to as a readable form. For that, in the authorization variable we have one method called getBytes. It's a string variable, right? It's a getBytes. Through this getBytes method, I am taking bytes data of the particular encrypted data. I am taking and assigning to here. Now I am decoding that encrypted data. I am decoding as a readable form. New string of base64 utils dot decode. This arg byte value is this string, right? I am converting it's a byte value. In the base64 utils dot decode, we have to pass byte value only. Okay, the byte array value. That byte array value I am decoding. It will decode and return back to as a like this. Suresh colon 123. It return like this. Okay. Suresh colon 123. Finally, the output like this. Suresh colon 123. Okay. Now next step is I want to validate the Suresh and the 123 is valid or not, which I entered from the client. This data coming from client side, right? Postman. After I want to validate this data. Which I configured here. Why? What I configured here? Suresh 123, right? I want to match. I want to match whatever value entered by user in a postman. That value I want to match here. I want to match here. Okay, now I'm taking Suresh colon 123. Now I want to split this. I want to take user alone. I want to take password alone. For that, I am saying basic auth and auth string split of colon. I want to make it two string variable. For that, I am using split of colon. So the split method return array of string. Split method return array of string. In the zeroth element, what will have? Suresh. In the oneth element, it has a 123. Okay. Now array of 0, I am taking username. Array of 1, I am taking password. Finally, now we got username and password, which is entered from the client. The next task, what is pending? I want to match. I want to validate this username and password against in a Spring Boot application. What I configured? I configured Suresh and 123, right? I want to match. Authentication manager. See here, I am using AutoVID authentication manager. This authentication manager, I configured here. I declared here. This class I am using for authentication. Okay. Now you understand why I declared this here. Okay. Authentication manager authenticate username, password, authentication token. This API coming from Spring Boot. Okay, using this API, I am passing whatever username password coming from Postman. I am passing that. Now this method authenticate. This method authenticate. If username password is matches with this username and password. Okay. This validate. This method validate whatever username and password. This username and password matches with matches with the Spring Boot username and password we have configured. Okay. If it is matches, it will come to next line. It will come to 49th line. Otherwise, it will go to bad credential exception. Otherwise, it will go to bad credential exception. Okay. Once come to 49th line, that meaning we understand that username password is successfully validated. Successfully validated. We can tell here. Username password is successfully validated. Okay. Then after successful validation, I want to take that user data. I want to take that user data. Validation completed. Now I want to take that user data for some future purpose. Okay. So customer detail service dot load user by name. Load user by username. I'm passing this username. I'm passing username which is coming from here. Then I'm assigning to here. Then I'm assigning here. Now this user detail contain all the user information. This username matches. Here we outcoded, right? Anyway, that will return user at 123. According to this line, this always return username at 123 and assign to user detail. Assign to user detail, right? Assign to user detail. Then here, username, password, authentication token, username, password, authentication token, new username, password, authentication token. Then passing this user detail which is taken from the load user by name. Then credential I am not passing. Then authorities, whatever authorities is having, I am passing here. I am passing and populating here. Populating this particular user. Populating this particular user. After populating, what I am doing here? Security context holder dot get context set authentication. Set authentication. After validating, I am populating that username and password. I am setting here authentication validator. Authentication validator. That meaning once you set this username and password, I can access the username and password anywhere in your REST endpoint. For example, I am trying to access this endpoint through this code. I validated successfully. Then I am setting this in security context. security context holder get context set authentication. I am setting this username and password token, user password authentication token. Once you set that, this data I can access here also. Who is the currently logged in user? Okay. So according to this code, I am taking the username and the password from the postman. I am decrypting that data. After decrypting, I am passing the authentication manager authenticate for validation. Then after authenticate, I am validating. I am loading that user from the database. I am loading that username database. If it is there, it will return. Otherwise, again it will return error. Okay. If it is there, it will return the user details. Then that user detail I am setting in the authentication security context. I am setting that in a security context. Once you set the security context, that username available in the security context, if you want in future, you can use it for any other purpose. Okay, this is the our own custom authentication. Okay, now we're going to see demo. In the debug mode also, you can see demo, no problem.
So this here some filters, right? Filter chain dot. Can I explain that?
Yeah. This is a very, very important. Sorry for to miss that. This is a very, very important filter chain dot do filter, right? See, whenever you create one filter, right? You know filter when it will execute. Everybody know filter before processing a request. There are many filter execute. Why? We can create any filter, many filters. Those filters execute before processing a request. After executing a particular filter, there must be some other process. After executing the filter, there will be some other process waiting for this process complete. Okay, that could be a next available filter or directly your controller class. Correct? After executing this filter, there might be a chance one more filter can execute. Otherwise, if there is no filter after this filter, directly go to the controller class get executed. I want to continue the process. Okay. That particular thing I am saying here, particular point I am saying through this filter chain dot do filter, pass this request and response to a next available activity. That could be again one more filter on controller. If you comment out this particular section, after this filter, according to our code, after this filter, this particular controller execute, right? This controller execute. That controller will not execute. This is a mandatory we have to add. If you create your own filter, in the all filter, we have to add filter chain dot do filter. You have to pass request and response. Then only next available filter execute. If there is no filter, next controller will execute. Whatever request endpoint requested by the client, that particular controller will execute. Okay. Through this method, you are saying execute next available filter or next or controller method that requested by client. Okay. Okay, now we're going to see the demo. So we started now. I'll go to the postman. I'll give some wrong one. In the authentication, I have configured Suresh something, right? Something I given. In the body, I have given a request data. I'll go to send a request forbidden. it gives the forbidden access. Okay, it's an authorization error. Okay, I'm not able to access this endpoint. Okay, now I'll go with the right author, right credential. Now I'm able to get the access. Okay, so through this, we are validating username and password in our home. This is called as a basic authentication. Okay, 1 minute, I'll go to restart in debug mode. Just to check that how is the data is coming from the client side.
Okay.
It's coming now. See, the authorization will have a basic space, some encrypted value, right? Now that encrypted value, I am only I'm taking that encrypted value. I am splitting as a username and a password. It's authenticated. Then populating into user detail. After populating, I am setting this data in security context. Then it's available in that particular username and password throughout the application. Whenever called REST endpoint, if you want, you can call that. Okay, I will tell you that tomorrow, I think all 9, how to access it. Okay. Still not subscribe this channel. Please subscribe it, share this video to your friend circle, click bell icon for regular updates. Thanks for watching this full video. Until then, bye bye from Suresh.